to this teaching point where we're going to talk about sample preparation. Considerations for sample prep include the sample type. Are you using a liquid sample, such as water or blood? Do you have adherent tissue culture samples, which may require enzymatic release? Or are you looking at solid tumors, which may require even more robust methods? Other considerations are the collection method. Are you going to have fixed or unfixed samples? How long is it going to take from you to collect the sample to you actually performing the assay to ensure that you handle and store it properly? And of course, there are always biosafety considerations, and you're encouraged to talk to your local biosafety officer to address any of those. In the case of purification of liquid samples, such as blood, one of the most common methods is the density gradient centrifugation. So here we take our sample, we overlay it on top of a glycol gradient, we spin that for a period of time, and we actually get a separation. Schematically, that looks like this. The top layer is your plasma layer. You have your peripheral blood cells, PBMCs, and your basophils, the layer of your phycol, and of course, your erythrocytes and granulocytes down here. You want to make sure you're very careful as you take this off and then wash it to move forward. Another step in purifying both liquid and other samples includes red blood cell lysis. The idea behind this is that we're going to remove red blood cells using a hypotonic solution, which is going to cause the cells to swell and burst. The osmolarity of this solution is critical because running the edge between lysing our red blood cells and lysing the cells that we're interested in. Additionally, timing is critical for this process. So if you're going to be using a red blood cell lysis solution, make sure you test it on the cells that you're going to be working with and validate the protocol. For more robust disassociated methods, we need to think about disaggregation. But of course, this needs to be as gentle as possible. And as always, in flow cytometry, monitoring the viability post-disaggregation is essential. For tissue culture samples, we can use enzymatic disruption methods. Some of these can strip the surface epitope, so you'll want to test that out and make sure that you're not losing anything on the surface that's of interest to you. If you're looking for more information, the Worthington Biochemical Tissue Disassociation Guide, and here's the website, is a great resource because it has many protocols for many different types of tissues, as well as the annotation of where that protocol was developed. Last but not least, remember you need to filter your samples before you run them on the flow cytometer, because nothing's going to ruin your day like a clog, especially if you're running a cell sorter. It's important to remember Shapiro's first law, that a 51 micron particle will clog a 50 micron orifice. Delving a little bit deeper into enzymatic digestion, protocols are going to vary based on the starting material. Again, the Worthington Tissue Disassociation Guide is an excellent resource. Time, temperature, and pH will affect your results. The other thing you need to consider is how are you neutralizing your enzymes and how that's going to affect your cells. Here's just a summary of some of the most common reagents out there. A lot of people use trypsin, and you'll notice that most times it's neutralized with serum. But consider trying soybean trypsin inhibitor to minimize the addition of divalent cations, which are necessary for cell adherence. For more robust disassociation methods, consider things like the GentleMax disassociator. This is a semi-automated process. You can purchase sterile tubes. It's like a mini wearing blender. It's good for a very small sample size. And they have worked out many predefined programs for a wide variety of tissues. Of course, you can go old school and use tituration or homogenization methodologies. Here are just some homogenizers that you may be familiar with. Of course, there's a wide variety of ways to do this. This can be harsher than the GentleMax, and often tituration and homogenization combined with enzymatic digestion to release the single cells. Any sort of methodology that you're using for isolation of your cells, remember the microscope is your best friend because it can let you determine if you have cells. Do you have a lot of clumping? You can look at, see if the cells are labeled if you have a fluorescence scope. Really, the microscope is your best friend. To summarize today, you need to know the sample origin. This is a liquid culture, monolayer, or a tissue. You want to be as gentle as possible to get your single cell suspension. Removal of red blood cells with lysis solution must be optimized. Now, when using enzymatic solutions, consider impact of neutralization on the cells. And again, for solid tumors, please consider how to be as gentle as possible.